Welcome to the third day of the USAID World Breastfeeding Week webinar series. Today we will continue to highlight the ways in which USAID implementing partners work to facilitate progress in breastfeeding together with a presentation from the ASSIST project about breastfeeding in the context of HIV-free survival. Be sure to join the rest of this week's webinar to hear about human milk feeding for small and sick newborns and the baby-friendly hospital initiative. And additional nutrition and breastfeeding resources can be found at these links that you can see on the screen right now. A few logistics before we begin. Please type any questions or thoughts you may have in the chat function on the bottom right-hand side of your WebEx window. So you will see a chat function, and it's also in the a tab on the top right-hand side. So if you click on that and then choose Send to All Participants on the Send to menu, then everyone on the webinar will be able to see your message. So I would like to test that out right now to make sure that it's working for everyone. Thank you to everyone who has joined us at this moment. Please go ahead and type in where you are listening from, the city you're listening from, and the weather in your city. And please make sure that you click on the Send to menu and select All Participants, so that everybody can see your message. While you're doing that, let's get started. Today's webinar will be presented by Amy Stern, Improvement Director with USAID ASSIST, Tamara Nsubuga-Nyombi, Senior Quality Improvement Advisor with ASSIST Uganda, and Linda Kisaakye, Program Officer with the Uganda Ministry of Health. Amy works on the ASSIST project with countries to improve the quality of HIV services. She manages the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival, a consortium of six countries working to improve services to prevent mother-to-child transmission of HIV, and leads activities to integrate nutrition assessments, counseling and support, or NAC, into HIV care and improve retention of antiretroviral therapy patients. She has many years of experience working on domestic quality initiatives with a focus on performance measurement and analysis against standards, quality improvement, and health services research. Tamara is a nutritionist and public health specialist with 9 years' experience working in the field of nutrition and HIV, infant and young child feeding, and community nutrition. Tamara's work as technical lead for PMTCT and nutrition with ASSIST Uganda involves supporting healthcare teams and USG implementing partners to apply the quality improvement approach to improve quality of care. Her work is currently focused on implementing proven EMTCT and nutrition interventions, documenting and spreading those lessons on a wider scale. Dr. Linda has worked in the health sector for over 11 years with experience in M&E, health system strengthening, capacity development, and clinical care. She has worked in clinical and program settings, primarily on HIV, with national, district, and sub-district governments, NGOs, donors, and development partners, notably UNICEF, CDC, and United States government agencies. In her current role in the Uganda MOH, Linda oversees the implementation of the National PMPCP program, providing technical guidance and stewardship to all implementing partners to ensure that the program is implemented per the national guidelines. Welcome to Amy, Tamara, and Linda. Again, to those of you listening in and to those who have just joined us, If you have any questions or comments during the webinar, please use the chat function on the right-hand side of this WebEx window. Type out your message and make sure that you choose all participants from the Send To drop-down menu so that everybody can read your comments. I see a few people have been chatting in. A few people from Washington, D.C., where it's a little overcast. Cambridge, Ontario, Canada. Hello, Colleen, where it's beautiful and sunny. Hello to Patrick with Assist in Northern Uganda, joining from Gulu. Thank you, everyone. And I see somebody joining from Burundi as well. All right. I will now turn it over to Amy to begin the webinar. Amy, all yours.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody. Could you go to the next slide, please? Thank you. Okay, so as many of you probably know, for an HIV-positive pregnant woman, each stage of pregnancy, labor, delivery, and postpartum constitutes a host of services. And there are many opportunities for a health facility to lose a patient or for a mother-baby pair to not return for care. When they do not receive the services they need, such as ART treatment, adherence support while breastfeeding, the likelihood of an HIV-exposed infant being infected with HIV is really high. We know that with no intervention, the risk of mother-to-child transmission is between 15 and 45%. And I'm going to focus on the, and this talk is going to focus on the postpartum period. And that is because, next slide, please, that we know that there's a drop in ARV coverage postpartum. Before delivery, 38% are not covered by ARVs. And postpartum, 51% of mothers are not protected by ARV during breastfeeding. Next slide, please. So the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival was designed to address this problem. The PHFS is a global project supported by PEPFAR with leadership from the WHO to reduce neonatal deaths due to malnutrition and diarrhea through optimal support of infant feeding practices and protection from transmission of HIV by giving mothers ART. PHFS had a demonstration phase, or really a proof of concept, from March 2013 through 2015, and this took place in six countries, to support the implementation of the WHO guidelines. Each country, together with their national counterparts in the mission, chose a small number of sites to learn how to do this better. The ASSIST project led the PHFS work in four countries, Kenya, Lesotho, Tanzania, and Uganda. And there was a three-year active learning phase to learn how to do this in countries, with the goal of embedding what is learned into national PMTCT and nutrition programs. Next slide, please. The unique focus of the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival is it focused both on protecting the baby from transmission and optimal infant feeding. So the mother was assessed for nutritional status at every visit and treated for if they were malnourished. The baby was also assessed and treated at each visit. Next slide, please. So PHFS promoted QI methods to address this problem and to address problems stemming from how care is organized. Now, quality improvement is a management approach that provides frontline workers with the skills and tools to change systems and processes of care at the frontline or the clinic level. They work in teams of healthcare workers to chart and use data to understand if the changes they are making to the processes within their clinic are improving services. Multiple teams are actively working on the same issue to learn from each other and to accelerate learning. Next slide, please. So So we use this peer-to-peer learning for a collaborative improvement, which brings many facilities that are trying to solve the same problem. It brings together many facilities that are trying to solve the same problem together. So individual facilities are testing changes and using data to understand if the change is resulting in the improvement. And then on a quarterly basis, the facilities are brought together for peer-to-peer learning, or this collaborative learning, which accelerates the learning. It also accelerates the pace of improvement, and often can have, there's some friendly competition that happens between the facilities. Next slide, please. So the first thing we needed to do was to break down the complex problem of improving HIV-free survival into more easily implementable phases. So each country visited a small number of sites to understand the problem, and then based on these visits and the collection of some baseline data, the gaps were clear. And based on this, we prioritized our work in this order. We needed to improve data systems to track mothers and babies and know what services they were receiving. We needed to keep mothers and babies in care because we know that we were losing them postnatally. We needed to provide critical package of care at the monthly visits, including nutrition assessment and care for mothers and babies, ARVs for mother and baby, cotrimoxazole for the baby, infant young child feeding counseling, and make sure that they knew when their next appointment was, when they needed to come back. And then fourth, we needed to provide a critical package of care at those special visits, or what we call them special visits, or really time-specific visits, like the six-week DNA PCR, the post-weaning and 18-month visit. So next slide, please. So this slide just shows you a picture of where we were at the baseline and what we accomplished. And as you can see at the baseline, it was very discouraging. The facilities were not able to identify all their HIV positive pregnant or breastfeeding mothers. They could not actually link the babies with the mothers, their babies with their mothers, and they didn't know if they were actually actively in care. That was a lot to work on, and we did, and you can see that they accomplished a tremendous amount in terms of keeping or retaining the mother and baby pairs in care. And now I'm going to turn it over to Tamara, who's going to talk more specifically about infant and young child feeding. Tamara?
Yeah, thank you, Amy. So I'm going to talk a bit more about what happened specifically to the infant and young child feeding within the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival, and describe what was done to improve both the counseling and the adherence to the feeding guidelines as well. So next slide, please. As Amy has already alluded, one of the things that we did first was to define a standard package of care that was to be given to every mother and her baby when they came to the facility. And the elements of that package included the infant and young child feeding. So the first thing that we did was to include it and have it integrated into the standard care package so that we were guaranteed that every time a mother and a baby came to the facility, they would get infant and young child feeding counseling as well as nutrition assessment for both the mother and the baby. Next slide. So this graph shows the percentage of HIV-positive mothers who received infant and young child feeding counseling in the 22 demonstration sites. And we compared this data with three sites that did not receive the intervention, just to look at the performance and be sure that the changes that the sites had tested had actually been put in place. Initially, when we went to these sites, there were issues to do with data collection, a mix-up in the messages that were being given around infant and young child feeding counseling, and there was no recording done for the services that have been provided. So some of the changes that were put in place to improve infant and young child feeding counseling, in addition to having them integrated as a standard package of care, was to have on-job training on how to use the codes for feeding, and what those different codes meant in the registers. But we also worked with health workers to simplify and give mothers key messages on infant and young child feeding for each of the different age groups, so that when mothers came to the facility, health workers knew what age their babies were, and they knew what message or what the key message was around feeding for that particular baby. We also empowered mothers through education to remind counselors or to remind the health workers about counseling in case they were not counseled. So because they knew that every time they came for a visit, they had to get a certain number of services, they were empowered and were reminding health workers. Next slide, please. This graph shows what happened to the adherence to infant and young child feeding practices across the 22 sites, the 22 demonstration sites. And here, to improve adherence to infant and young child feeding, we worked with mentor mothers or peer mothers to support mothers in the family support groups, but also to carry out home visits and check that indeed the mothers were adhering to the guidelines. So if they were meant to be exclusively breastfeeding, that indeed they were exclusively breastfeeding their babies. If they were meant to start complementary feeding at 6 months, that they were doing that. We also integrated education on infant and young child feeding and nutrition in the family support groups, and had food demonstrations in some sites to demonstrate to mothers, especially around the complementary feeding period, how to prepare foods, what variety of foods to be given. And to verify adherence, health workers were encouraged to ask open-ended questions about what mothers had been feeding their babies on, or asking mothers to demonstrate how they were breastfeeding so that they could check for any issues around that area. At the end of the demonstration phase, we were able to pick up the changes and determine what worked and what didn't work to lead to improvement. And we took these changes and rolled them up to additional sites. And as you'll see in the next slide, that we've seen an improvement in infant and young child feeding adherence at scale. This is data from 95 spread sites, mainly from northern Uganda, demonstrating the improvement in infant and young child feeding adherence across all the sites. These are four different waves, so each wave has about 25 sites. And I would just like to draw your attention to the numbers in the figures to speak to what Amy was saying about having to retain mothers and keep them in care for longer, that over time, the number of babies in care or who are seen has also increased or doubled from the start, which is about July 2015 to June of 2017. So we're also, not only are we improving adherence, but we're also able to keep more mothers and babies in care for a longer period of time. Next slide. Similarly, we were able to take the changes from the demonstration sites and use a change package to improve provision of a standard package of care at scale, still in the 95 sites. And we've seen remarkable improvement in all of these areas as well. So in terms of what we know, next slide, we've learned that the interpersonal relations are key. So for mothers, patient-provider relations have centered on quality education and counseling and motivating patients to remain in care. So for many women, more counseling on how to maintain a healthy lifestyle and keep their babies HIV-free were important improvements in the quality of services. And then we've also learned that mothers are able to describe the changes in quality themselves, the changes in quality of the services that they received. They were able to describe what was happening to them before we had the PHFS and the improvement work happening in their sites, and what was happening to them in terms of care after this. So for example, they know that they've got improved and improved education on treatment adherence and feeding practices, and more counseling on how to maintain a healthy lifestyle and keep their babies HIV free. And these were examples that were taken from interviews that were done with mothers in the demonstration sites, and that was the feedback that we received. So it validated our work or improvement. I'm going to hand over to Dr. Linda, who will talk a bit more about this work at the national level. Linda.
So next slide, please. So the partnership work came at around the time when Uganda had just adopted B plus and worked through scaling up B plus for about 2 years. We adopted B plus in 2012, and around the time we started the partnership work, we had scaled up to all the districts in the country, but we were facing a number of challenges, especially in issues of retention of mother and baby pairs. So we were able to learn from the sites that had been implementing these initiatives on what actually works, and we incorporated them into our guidelines and scaled them up to all facilities that were implementing PMTCT at that time. So because of that, we then developed what was called the Mother Baby Care Point, where all services for the mother and baby were offered, and the patient card for both the mother and baby put together at that care site. And then all services are integrated for mother and baby within the Mother Baby Care Point. So about 3 months ago, we went back to evaluate the work, what has had happened at the Mother Baby Care Point. We visited 84 sites across all the 14 regions in Uganda, and we were able to see what is actually happening at those sites. We found that over 90% of facilities were actually providing services as per the guidelines. The services that we had outlined that should be offered at the Mother Baby Care Point, and because of the what we have learned from the partnership for HIV-Free Survival, both the health workers and the mothers actually knew what services should be provided at each of the care points. We found that there's consistency in the services that we interviewed over 1,000 mothers and 197 health workers, and we found that there was consistency in what both the mothers and the health workers are saying about the services that they are offered. The mothers were reporting the services that they have been given at those facilities, and these were the same services that the health workers were reporting to actually be offering at those particular at the mother baby care point. And health education, infant and young child feeding, counseling, ARV refills were almost universal in all the facilities. So when you look at the graph on the left side, over 80% of mothers were getting septrin and ART, and in over 50% of the mothers were actually reporting that they were getting infant and young child feeding counseling, although nutrition assessment was in over 65% reported by over 65% of mothers. Next slide. This just goes to show that by improving the processes, we are able to improve the final outcomes. So ideally, because we improved the way care was given at the facilities by standardizing the services that the mothers are supposed to give, by standardizing where services should be offered, and appointment tracking, we were able to retain a bigger number of mother baby pairs in care. And also we've seen that HIV transmission from mother to baby has continued to decrease, as shown by the red line on the graph below. Next slide. So in summary, this goes to show that by putting all the different pieces together, ensuring that you empower the mothers and also supporting the health system so that the health workers know what they are supposed to do. Again, working with a robust data system, it helps to help you retain more mother baby care, their payers in care, and also provide a standard package of services to the mother and baby, leading to better outcomes for both the mother and the baby. Thank you. Over to Ami.
Okay, thank you, Tamara, and thank you, Linda. I would just like to take a moment here to acknowledge the support for this work, particularly from USAID, and most specifically, Tim Quick, who has been a supporter and a champion for this work and continues to be, to PEPFAR, WHO, and UNICEF, all the PHFS partners, which include IHI, FANTA, and LIFT, the country implementing partners, which there are many in each country, and specifically our USAID Assist project staff and our Ministry of Health counterparts from Uganda. Thank you so much, and this work would have never been done, or we would have never helped so many mothers and babies without your support, so thank you. Anissa, do you want to do the last slide?
Of course. Thank you very much to Amy, Tamara, and Dr. Linda for a very informative presentation. If any of the attendees have questions or comments, please feel free to type it into the chat box right now. And while you are doing that, I just want to draw your attention to this slide right here. If you would like to receive more information about PHFS and the quality improvement approaches that were used, please contact Amy, myself, or Tim Quick at these addresses below. And we have also created a learning platform for the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival that's accessible via this web address right here. And for those who are asking, you can go to this learning platform and under webinars, you will find a copy of this presentation as well as the recording of this webinar there in a few days. So I see a couple of questions already, and thank you to people who are writing in your questions. Jennifer has a question asking, how did the intervention address gender-related barriers to retention in care?
I think Tamara and Linda, do you want to talk about some of the interventions you did in Uganda for that?
Sure. So in overall, the not just for the infant and young child feeding, but for the generally the PHFS intervention, particularly for the retention of mother-baby pairs, integrated or sought to involve men in care or in their partner's care or their child's care. And that was one of the changes that we saw being implemented by some sites, not across all the 22 sites, but in some sites we saw them integrating or involving more males in care so that they were supporting their children and their partners to come to the facility, either by coming with them or by paying transport or being part of their care generally. In other areas, what we're seeing is involving males as peers to reach out to fellow men, particularly when it comes to still the retention and to the what we call the special visits, where the children have to come to routinely get different tests. We've found that males are more involved in that because they're interested in the outcome of their baby, and so they will support them to come for care, remind them and they also do men, I mean, they mentor, they talk to other men about this as well.
Thank you, Tamara. Jennifer, I hope that answers your question. Sophie has a question asking if you could please clarify which key indicators are used to measure adherence to IYCF practices.
Okay.
Tamara, if you would like to take that one.
In this particular case, what we looked at was reported adherence. So what proportion or the number of mothers who reported adherence to infant and young child feeding as the numerator, and the denominator being the total number of babies seen in the clinic that day.
Okay. Thank you. And the slide with the denominator is up for anyone who's interested in taking a closer look. Esther has a question for Linda. What has the MOH put in place to ensure mother-baby care points remain functional without project support?
Okay. So, as I said, around 2015, when we were rolling out the guidelines around 2014 for the treatment for all children under 2014, we included as part of the guidelines the service delivery model for PMPCT services, and therefore said that mother baby care point was the prescribed model of service delivery for all PMPCT implementing services. And then under that module, we also outlined what should be done for all the mother baby care points, what services should be provided there, the kind of health workers that should be there, and medicine. Set out proper guidelines on what a mother-baby care point should be like. So all the what the partners did was to help us ensure that there's space for a mother-baby care point, and also procure some equipment. But otherwise, the service delivery, the running of the mother-baby care point, the ensuring that all this was going on was done by the health workers at the health facility, and all the different PMPCT implementing facilities went through that training, which was a facility-based training, during which, before the end of the training, we would support the health workers to see this place for them to set up the mother baby care point, and also work through with them services that would be provided at the mother baby care point. And we also, at that training, was the focal point person out of the Ministry of Health staff at the facility on who was going to head the mother baby care point. So basically, it was the guideline. So that was the norm. That is the norm now for PMPCT implementation. And whether partners are there or partners are not there, that is how services are actually offered for all PMPCT implementing facilities.
Thank you, Dr. Linda. And there is another question for you from Judy asking, is there any thought on the part of the Uganda MOH about using a similar approach to care for all mother-baby pairs, so going beyond ART clinics and HIV-positive women and exposed infants?
Essentially, Uganda services for PMPCT are integrated within the MCH clinic. So the mother-baby care point is located within MCH. So it is located within MCH. So all these services, although specifically that particular room is catering to the mother-baby care point, but the health workers are trained to offer services across to all mothers irrespective of the HIV status. So basically, they can still offer all the different services that are with the other negative mothers as well, because they are within the MCH service area. Although, of course, the emphasis has been more on the HIV positive mothers, we've now come to realize that there's a lot of transmission, especially during the breastfeeding period. And so now we are extending our work to make sure that we try to keep the mothers who test negative on the first, during adventure, with us again within MCH, so that we continue to monitor them. Now the mothers are actually turning positive later during the breastfeeding period because they were not given as special attention as the mothers who test positive on the testing within complaint. So, we are trying to work with the reproductive health people to see that whatever we are doing acts across for all mother baby care, but it is still work in progress.
Thank you. And the next question is from Patrick, and he asks, has the intervention improved nutrition outcomes among infants and young children who are HIV exposed?
Yes, I have to say it has improved a lot. Outcomes, even the nutrition outcomes. When we did the recent mother baby care point evaluation, we found that most of the mothers are actually adhering to the guidelines. They are exclusively breastfeeding for at least 6 months. And those who are HIV positive are also, continuing to breastfeed and even up to 12 months of age. And when you look at the exposed infants, also a number of them are coming out HIV free, at the same time, they are healthy and their nutrition indicators are actually very good.
Thank you. And Esther has a follow-up comment where she says, thank you, Linda. I know the guideline was rolled out in Uganda because of your own personal effort.
Okay, thank you.
There is a question from Maero, and he asks, I would be interested in seeing the percentage of health providers who offer a complete package of care via the mother's response.
So as Linda mentioned earlier, we are reviewing the evaluation or the results from the evaluation. And we don't have that percentage per se, but the slide that she showed reports that the services which the health workers said they provide were actually validated by the mothers who had received them as well. So, and then we have qualitative information from the mothers saying that they do, when they come to the facility, they do have the services that they receive. They receive a complete package of services. They've never had an issue with. They've never missed out on services that they have prioritized. So I don't have an actual number at the moment, but we would be more than happy to provide it once we're done with the statistical evaluation.
Thank you, Tamara and Dr. Linda. I don't see any other questions in the chat box, so if there are any last comments or questions, please go ahead and put it in there. I am going to ask each of the presenters if you have any final comments that you would like to make about the partnership or about any of the results that we just looked at.
From what I've learned or what I know is that we need to always identify the critical elements of the care pathway, because we realize that what we're trying to do is to bring two systems together, the ART system and the care system for nutrition, and oftentimes health workers get bogged down by a lot of messages, a lot of guidelines, a lot of information that they have to absorb. But by simplifying and working with them to identify the critical elements of that care pathway, I think we're able to get more results. And so and make it simpler for them to actually do their job properly and provide quality services for them, for mothers and babies.
Maybe for me, as a policy person, I'm keen for implementing partners as they come up with very good innovations and research. Always involve the Minister of Health right from the beginning.
So many people do very many good things, but once the policy people are not, involved in the implementation, in the monitoring of the initiatives, then it becomes a lot difficult to pick up those initiatives and make them as part of policy. But once you work with the policy people right from the beginning in both implementation, in the supervision, in the monitoring, then they can see for themselves that these innovations are actually working. So even before you document the best practices, they are already picking them up quickly and inputting them as part of policy, and then it's easier to scale up those initiatives across, implementing facilities.
Thank you. Amy, any final thoughts?
Yes, thank you, Anissa. I think my final thought was, as everyone can see from the Uganda data, we have learned a tremendous amount, and we've really been able to provide better care for mothers and babies. And this is true across all the PHFS countries. So I just hope that the word on what was accomplished through the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival in each country is widely heard, and the interventions that we have been shown to work, that it gets spread within each of those, the PHFS countries and beyond globally, so we can provide better care for mothers and babies. Thank you.
Thank you. And once again, thank you to all three of you presenters for describing the QI work and how it has helped to improve processes and ultimately improve some outcomes as well. I found it very interesting, and I know that a lot of work went into getting the kind of results that we're seeing in Uganda as well as in the other PHFS demonstration sites in other countries. Thank you to all of the attendees for your attention and your participation. Once again, the video of this webinar and the actual PowerPoint presentation will be available on the PHFS learning platform, and the link is up here on this slide. If you go to that link and you click on webinars, this presentation will be available there in the next few days. The learning platform also hosts our past webinars with the PHFS. Quarterly webinars were held over the past 2 or 3 years. And there are many other resources, including what you see on the screen, a photo of a change package. There are 3 of those from Uganda, a change package from Tanzania, as well as a whole host of other case studies, reports, et cetera, on the learning platform, all of which are accessible to you. With that, I think we can end for today. Have a wonderful morning or wonderful evening, and thank you all again for attending and for participating.
Thank you.